Basil and Apophysis. At a particularly crucial point in his argument, Basil says, according to De Ferrari's translation of his letters, if they, that is the Eunomians, find us confessing that we know, demand of us knowledge of the substance, and if they see that we are cautious about making our answer, turn upon us the reproach of impiety. As the Greek and Evosin Imamos, Menos Prostin Apophasi. This passage turns on the word apophasis, from which word words we derive emphatic. I think that the significance of this eluded De Ferrari. That the meaning of apophasis here, in fact, concerns denial or negation, is corroborated in the opening lines of letter 234, as cited above. If we confess that we do not know the substance, apophasis in this context, therefore, is the theological corollary of agnosis, not knowing. We might attempt to retranslate the full context as follows, quote, "For since the word knowledge has many meanings, and a thing can be known in respect to number, and size, and power, and manner of subsistence, and time and generation, and substance, they, taking it in a general sense of their questioning, if they find us confessing that we know, demand of us knowledge of the substance, and if they see us maintaining reverence with a denial," translated into English, observing reverence in view of a denial, perhaps, turn upon us the reproach of impiety. But we, for our part, confess that we know what is knowable about God, while on the other hand, to know anything that escapes our comprehension is impossible. But knowledge is manifold, as we have said, for it is the apprehension of him who created us, and the understanding of his wonders, and the keeping of his commandments, and intimacy with him. Unquote. Knowing in part. It is a principle of Basil that our knowledge of God is proportioned to our limited human capacity. Elsewhere, he expresses this in the phrase of Paul in 1 Corinthians 13, verses 9 and 12, that we know in part. In his On the Faith, later used as a preface for Moralia, he explains how progress in the knowledge of God is gradual and tentative. Such knowledge grows by steps towards a relative plenitude in the life that is to come, to which we are always striving. He begins with the principle for the incomprehensibility of God's nature. Quote, "The nature of the majesty and glory of God is incomprehensible in word and uncontainable by mind, and cannot be demonstrated or understood by one phrase or thought, but requires a number of those in current use. The God breathes scripture with difficulty, hints darkly to the pure in heart, as in a mirror. For to see face to face and to know perfectly is promised in the age to come to those worthy of receiving it. But now, even though it be a Peter or Paul, one sees truly what one sees, and is neither deceived nor the victim of a phantasm. Yet one sees in a mirror and darkly, and receiving now with gratitude what is only in part, one waits with joy for that which is perfect in the future. Similarly, that which now seems perfect in knowledge, if compared with the knowledge that shall be revealed to the worthy in the age that is to come, is so slight and obscure that it falls more short of the clarity of the age to come than seeing through a glass, and that darkly falls short of face to face." The God who reads scripture is as greatly conscious of the unlimited character of knowledge as it is of the unattainability of the divine mysteries of the present time by human nature. Since to each, according to his progress, more is always being added, and yet he ever falls short of worthy achievement, until that which is perfect comes, when that which is in part shall be done away with. That's exegesis of scripture for you. Was Basil the Great, that is, the man of advanced holiness, but mature in an ever deepening experiential knowledge of God? The evidence of his own testimony confirmed Gregory Nyssa's interpretation that Basil was, by any reckoning, a Christian mystic. But was he also a mystical theologian, in the sense of one who tends to articulate an account of the more mature reaches of the life in Christ? When beginning this essay, I had been expecting him to find that perhaps he was not. Instead, I was surprised to find his discourse planted thickly with the seeds of the mystical theology, even with the elements of an apophatic mystical theology. It seems that in the last years before his all too premature death, Basil tentatively probed the implications for the experience of the Christian spiritual life of the theology of the divine infinitude and incomprehensibility.